Moses did with the power of God. Moses brought them out of the bondage to the promised land. Now, from Egypt to Mount Sinai, it was 3 months' journey. Walking along the road, crossing the Red Sea and all the things, and when they reached Mount Sinai, God told Moses, "See, I have fulfilled my promise. Now you are on your own. Yet, if you want me to be your God and you want me to be my people, you have to obey and listen to what I am saying." Because God seen the bickerings and the complaints Moses had to face from the people. Therefore, this commandment was a result of the covenant that made at Mount Sinai. How many covenants God made? Important covenant. First covenant with Abraham. Personal covenant. Second covenant with Noah. Family covenant. Third covenant at Mount Sinai with his own people. This is the first time God is speaking to such a big crowd directly. All the time God was speaking through his anointed ones. And do you know how many people were there at Mount Sinai, at the foot of Mount Sinai? Any idea? 12 to 13 lakhs people were there. Counting God's people and who were decided to come away from Egypt, foreigners, all of them. 12 to 13 lakhs people. And I am sure it is Moses' request that God wanted to speak to them. Because when Moses talked to them, they had a lot of problems to believe in Moses. So Moses said, God said, okay, I will talk to these people. And before I can talk to these people, he said, you have to sanctify yourself. You have to get rid of all your sinful habits for 3 days. Sanctification. You have to purify yourself. And we get the teaching, first teaching of the Ten Commandments in Exodus chapter 20 and later on in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 5 onwards. Now in Exodus chapter 19:5, God says, if you have to be my people, if you want me to be your God, you have to listen to my word and obey all the commandments. They said, okay Lord, we will do whatever you say. And thereafter, in next chapter, Exodus chapter 20, 1 onwards, God is giving them the commandments, 10 commandments. These commandments were written on the stone tablets. Before, when Adam and Eve was created, all the humankind, these commandments were given to them, but it was not written down. It was there in their mind. Thereafter, God gave them the first commandment. I told you about 3 covenants before I forget. The 4th covenant was with David. The covenant with 2 nations, Judah and Israel. And the 5th and the most important covenant, anybody remembers? Who gave the 5th most important covenant for the entire universe, for the entire world? Jesus. So 5 commandments. All right. So when God gave them the commandment that you shall have no other God but me, God. Now tell me, in today's world, there are so many religions all claiming to be a true God. Is there any other God than our God? We will say our God is the true God. But every religion says their God is true God. So how will you make out which is the true God? All the religions, when they see the creation, the works of the God, they say, yes, there is a God who created it. Hindu, Muslim, all the religions, it is the God who created it. We also, when see the glory of God, say God created and God controls it. One. God is, in that case, God is one for everybody. But when we come to special revelation that is given to us, it's only given to us Catholics. Why I say Catholics? Because from Christianity, lot of other religion has gone away. People have gone away and formed their own religion. So this special revelation is not given to any other God, any other religion. In Hebrews chapter 1 and 2, Hebrews chapter 1 and 2, will somebody read that? Hebrews chapter 1 and 2. Anybody with a Bible? New Testament, Hebrews chapter 1 and 2. Yes. 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 In the past, God spoke through prophets and holy people in many and different ways. But in the last days, God spoke to us through His only Son. That's the last revelation. No more revelation till the end of the world. So we, when you look at the creation, the glory of God, we say that is our God. And then we believe in what Jesus is. But this privilege and blessing is not given to other religions, with all respect to them. Because you can see and what fruits the other religions are producing. They say God is one, but the God is teaching something else. Violence and all this kinds of thing that is happening in the world is because of their wrong teaching. We have nothing to say about it. With due respect, God will handle it. Now coming back to the first covenant. So there is only one God. Isaiah 44:6 says, there is no other God than our God. Jeremiah says, ours is the true God. Jesus says, we are the true God. Now when we don't understand this, and we fall for the ways of the world, we get carried away. Today, most of the, I have nothing against any countries, I'm just stating you a fact. The most advanced country in the world is today, which is the advanced country? America. Everybody wants to rush there, good for them, because of prosperity. But do you know, my brothers and sisters, we cannot in the States today say, God created heaven and earth. It's banned. You cannot say, you can say in private in the church, but in public if you say, God created heaven and earth, you are hauled up. In the States, most advanced country, in the communist countries, you know, there is no religion. So why I am saying this is, we as the chosen people have given this revelation to worship the Lord. What did Moses tell Pharaoh? My people must go a 3 days journey to worship the Lord. What is worshiping the Lord? Worshiping the Lord in one way. In our church, in the Catholic, Roman Catholic Church, only this worship happens only in this church. We must know about it. No other church has got this altar. The splinter groups that have gone out, 40,000 denominations that have gone out after the Reformation, after 1529, 40,000 denominations, the numbers were, they don't have this altar. They have a podium there. They have a lectern there. They don't have the Eucharistic worship. We have privilege, we have been privileged. We have the Eucharistic worship and we believe the only Eucharistic celebration that happened 2000, more than 2000 years, it's coming down to be in this altar. Worshipping the Lord means to participate in the Eucharistic sacrifice prime, first and foremost. Jesus glorified his Father because of his sacrifice. This is the worshipping the Lord. If we don't understand this, if we don't participate in the Eucharist, with this understanding, what is going to happen to us? That is what we are going to share today, time permitting. Okay? Now, from 2083 to 2141, the big teaching, 58 paragraph, 58 teachings are there. We'll try to attempt the first from what happens when we don't understand and worship God, our Lord, what is going to happen. In Exodus chapter 23, 25 says, when my people come and worship me, I will bless their bread and water, and I will take away their sickness and all the problems. Our God is a rewarding God. When you come and worship, He is not going to leave you empty-handed. He is going to bless our bread and water. He is going to take away our sickness. He is going to bless our families. Now this is what we are going to understand. Why are we not growing in faith, hope and charity? We will basically confine this teaching only to faith, hope and charity. Is our faith growing day by day? Are we losing hope in God? Are we failing in charity to love one another? We will understand this. So as my brother Titus, I request Titus to read from the teachings on first, on faith there are three paragraphs, on hope there are three paragraphs, and on charity there are two paragraphs. Time permitting, God willing, we can complete them. Alright? Listen carefully. 2087. What is the title given there?
Faith.
Faith. Okay, read it.
Faith.
No, you read it like that.
Our moral life has its source in faith in God, who reveals His love to us.
Yeah. You understood? Our moral life, our morality, our principles, depends as such in the source of faith in God, who reveals His love to us. Is that clear? If our faith has to increase, we must know how God is going to love us. Read further.
Saint Paul speaks of the obedience of faith as our first obligation.
Saint Paul speaks of obedience of faith as our first obligation. When you say first obligation, for we Catholics, Roman Catholics, our vocation is to worship God. Not to become a doctor, engineer, PhD, whatever it is. That comes secondary. When we give more importance to those things, our career, we are not giving God the first place. Of course these things are good. Your career is very good. We have to have a good future. But let it not overtake the love for God. Read further.
He shows that ignorance of God is the principle and explanation of all moral deviation.
Yes. Ignorance of God, ignorance of Scripture, is the principal cause when we deviate from the teachings of the God, from the values of God. Am I making it clear? Okay. Read further.
Our duty toward God is to believe in Him and to bear witness to Him.
Yes. Unless we bear witness, we become a witness to God. How do we become a witness to God? We have first-hand information. We have first-hand information starting from our family. If we are not a good witness to God, our children are bound to go astray. That's what's happening. We have not understood. We are not given the first place. That is 2087. Now you read 2088.
The first commandment requires us to nourish and protect our faith with prudence and vigilance, and to reject everything that is opposed to it.
Yeah. Read again. The first commandment.
The first commandment requires us to nourish and protect our faith with prudence and vigilance.
Yeah.
And to reject everything that is opposed to it.
The first command requires us to nourish and protect our faith with prudence. What is prudence? Right judgment, right understanding of the things. And vigilant. We have to be vigilant. When are we going to get carried away by the worldly ways? You walk around anywhere, the world is telling us something different. We are the only people who are shouting against the world. Why is so much of persecution for us? Because we stand against the values of the world. Okay?
There are various ways of sinning against faith.
There are various ways against sinning against our faith. Various ways. We are not aware of it. Why our faith is not growing? Someday we are falling short. We are getting carried away by the world. Money is a good thing. We need money. God wants us to be prosperous people. God wants us to be successful people. But what is the promise God said in Exodus chapter 20? What is God telling these people first? If you worship me, I'll take care of everything. You don't worry about how you're going to provide for your children, your future, your pension plan, all this thing. You don't worry. Leave it to me. Unless we understand and believe and act, our faith will not grow. Okay, next one.
Voluntary doubts about the faith disregards or refuses to hold as true what God has revealed and the church proposes for belief.
Voluntary doubt. What is voluntary doubt? Doubt about God's promises. Will God fulfill my promise? I've lost my job. I've got a big family to take care of. I have a relationship problem. My children have gone, left the church. My wife has left the church. My husband has left the church. They don't pray. So many crises. Voluntary crises. Read further.
Involuntary doubts refers to hesitation in believing.
Yeah, in involuntary doubts. When we read the word of God, when we hear the word of God, doubts are naturally bound to arise in us. When doubts come to us, whether God is going to be faithful, what is the meaning of covenant?
Agreement.
It's not, it's much, much more than agreement. Agreement is between two parties, two persons. We can break the agreement anytime. Covenant is between you and your God, me and my God. I can be unfaithful to God, but God will never, never be unfaithful to us. His faithfulness will last? No. As long as you believe. If you are unfaithful at the time of growing up, God cannot save us. God will never break His promise till you have breath in life. You know, God cursed that fig tree, Jesus cursed the fig tree. Why did He curse? Because that was not the season for them to produce the fruit. It's written in the Bible. When is the season for us to produce faith, hope and charity? When is the season for us? Yeah? As long as we have breath in us. Once the breath is gone, we cannot produce anything. And then we have a false notion. God is a punishing God. Is God going to punish us? No, God will never punish us for whatever sins we do. But we will be repaid. Punishment is not the right word. We will be repaid for our actions. That consequence we have to bear. Whatever we do, good or bad, there is a repayment. God's people, 430 years it took them to repay the things. Who sins? Parents sins. But we are so privileged today, we don't have to wait for 430 years or 200 years. Our sins, we commit sins, and the sin is passed on to our children. The consequence of our sin will definitely be there on the children. What is the remedy? What is the remedy? God said, Jesus too will give us a remedy. What is the remedy? Baptism. That is what Nicodemus came to Jesus, the teacher of the law. He was the teacher of the law. He gave, Lord, what should I do to be saved? Jesus said, what is born of flesh is flesh. The Old Testament people. What is born of spirit? What in spirit? Spirit. So when we baptize our children, all the effects of parents, our grandparents, our ancestral curse, all that is wiped away when we baptize and stay baptized. How do you stay baptized? How do you stay baptized? Baptism is very easy when bring the church, Father, baptize the church. How do we stay baptized? What happens in the baptism? Response, please. Sins are taken away. How do we stay baptized? Every time we commit a sin, be baptized. What is the other sacrament for baptism? Confession. So as long as we are taken, we take away our sins, we are baptized, we stay in the grace of baptism. Alright? Are you following what I'm saying? So this Old Testament teaching is not applicable to us as long as we stay baptized, as long as we are baptized and stay baptized without sin. Okay.
Involuntary doubts refers to hesitation in believing, difficulty in overcoming objections connected with the faith,
yeah,
or also anxiety aroused by its obscurity.
Yeah. Anxiety, then involuntary doubts. If we don't get it clear, it will give us anxiety, depression. Today, what is the common sickness? Everybody is depressed. Why should we be depressed? What is the cause? Why? If you fail in exam, children get depressed, we get depressed. Because you failed in exam. If you lose your job, we get depressed. If we have a broken relationship, we get depressed. Why? Why? That is a human tendency to get depressed. But God says, no, don't worry. Hope, have hope. We are learning about faith and hope. So when we have faith in God, we will never get depressed. Depression comes, say, get behind me, Satan. Get behind me, Satan. It is from Satan. It is from the evil one. Read.
If deliberately cultivated doubt can lead to spiritual blindness.
Yeah. Read one more time.
If deliberately cultivated, doubt can lead to spiritual blindness.
Spiritual blindness. If these doubts are not clear, if we are not a true witness, if we are not acting together, this can lead to spiritual blindness. You know what is spiritual blindness? What is spiritual blindness? You can talk 24 hours, you can preach from this podium. 24 hours you got to go for confession. But if you don't believe in this, it is spiritual blindness. You come for church, Eucharistic everyday celebration. But what are we going back with? With what disposition are we coming for the Eucharist? Are we coming in joyful expectation? What is the biggest sin that is happening, biggest thing that is happening in the Eucharist? Before the priest who is standing in front of all the altar, lifting up the host and saying, "The Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, forget about my sins. He is prepared to take the sins of the world, provided you give it to Him." Are we coming to the Eucharist celebration without giving the sin to Him, without expecting that God is going to take away my sins? What a relief for us. Supposing we are, most of us have got house loans, mortgage. It's a big amount for working people at least. And one fine morning, the housing authority will say, "Your entire loan has been waived off." What do you feel? Happy or sad? Say, you will feel relieved, your burden is gone. But this is something much, much more than that. Much, much, which causes to depression, which causes to isolation, which causes to suicide. God is saying, "I will take away my sins, your sins. Give it to me." If you don't entertain involuntary doubt in us, don't doubt God, in other words, don't doubt in the efficacy of the word of God. Please do not doubt. If God says He will do it, He will do it. Maybe we will have to go through certain period of restitution. Doesn't matter. God will be faithful. Okay, this is about
2089.
Yeah.
Incredulity is the neglect of revealed truth.
Yeah.
Or the willful refusal to assent to it.
Incredulity is the neglect of revealed truth. What is the revealed truth to us? What is the truth? What is that one word for truth? Jesus. He says, "I am the truth." If you have doubt in what Jesus said, he said, you are unbelieving Jesus. Read further.
Heresy is the obstinate post-baptismal denial of some truth which must be believed with divine and Catholic faith, or it is likewise an obstinate doubt concerning the same. Apostasy is the total repudiation of the Christian faith. Schism is the refusal of submission to the Roman Pontiff or of communion with the members of the Church subject to Him.
Heresy, other teachings from the other denominations, other teachings from other worldly sources, it's heresy. Don't believe this. Don't believe. Don't send, text. Read, do. Say 10 Hail Marys and say this prayer and pass it on to your next best friend. This is all heresy. God never told us to do all these things. How many text messages we get every day? Do this and you will get this. Are we putting God to test? Or are we not believing in what God has said? Text message. How many messages we get? These are all heresies, works of the Satan. We have to rush. Okay, this is regarding the hope.
Yeah, okay.
Faith.
Now we go to hope.
We have to rush to.
Yeah. 2090.
Yeah.
When God reveals Himself and calls Him, man cannot fully respond to the divine love by his own powers. He must hope that God will give him the capacity to love Him in return and to act in conformity with the commandments of charity. Hope is the confident expectation of divine blessing and the beatific vision of God. It is also the fear of offending God's love and of incurring punishment.
Punishment. What does it mean? In short, he says, do not depend on your knowledge. Do not depend on your merit. Do not depend on your position. Do not depend on your success. depend on God. When we get prosperous, when we become successful, when we get what is happening today, the more you God bless you, the far away you go from God. You're losing faith in God, hope in God. Read further.
The first commandment is also concerned with sins against hope, namely despair and presumption.
That we already covered that too. Okay. By despair,
man ceases to hope for his personal salvation from God, for help in attaining it, or for the forgiveness of his sins.
Yes. When we despair, it shows that we have no hope in the forgiveness of sin. When you despair, when the sin is with us, and when we go for confession, still we despair, means the confession is incomplete. God is telling you something. God is close to us. When we are in despair, when we are in trouble, when we are in sickness, God is telling us, not the other way around. We believe God is punishing us, God is, we must have done something wrong. No! God is close to us when something adverse happened to us, sickness happened to us, God is telling us something. Read.
Despair is contrary to God's goodness.
Yes.
Despair is contrary to God's goodness, to His justice, for the Lord is faithful to His promises and to His mercy.
Despair means contrary to God's promise, God's goodness.
There are two kinds of presumption.
Yes.
Either man presumes upon his own capacity,
yes,
hoping to be able to save himself without help on high, or he presumes upon God's almighty power or His mercy, hoping to obtain His forgiveness without conversion and glory without merit.
Yes. The biggest block today, we are hoping to obtain forgiveness without conversion. We want to be saved, but I am not prepared to change. I am not prepared to give away my sinful ways, my anger, my pride, my whatever it is. I am not prepared to give it. I will come to church, I will receive the communion in an unworthy manner, still go out and do the same thing. If there is no conversion, there is no hope for us. Very clear. If we are not prepared to change ourselves, forget about God. Nothing is going to happen. Nothing will save us. That is faith, hope, and charity. Just run through.
Charity.
Yeah.
Faith in God's love encompasses the call and the obligation to respond with sincere love to divine charity. The first commandment enjoins us to love God above everything and all creatures for Him and because of Him.
If we love God, we cannot hate anybody. If we love God, we have to accept others as they are. Don't expect them to change. Who are we to change people? If God cannot change us, how can I change others? Accept people as they are with their shortcomings. In our ministries, we find this happening every time. We don't want to accept others. God given ministry to all different ministries. We don't want to accept, we don't want to associate with them if they are not of like-minded thinking. Read further.
One can sin against God's love in various ways.
One can sin against God's love in various ways, and we are not aware, sometimes we are not aware of it. There are people who come into church every day receiving communion in this parish and not prepared to forgive with the family members. Not prepared to go and say, sorry, come on, let's reconcile. You think God is going to hear our prayers? You going to think we'll grow in charity and loving God? We have taken it very lightly. You know, this person has hurt me so much. We are maybe correct, 100% correct. But what is God saying? That you accept them, so you will change that person. If you are going to hurt that person, you are not going to. You cannot change him and you cannot change yourself. Read further.
indifference neglects or refuses to reflect on divine charity. It fails to consider its prevalent goodness and denies its power.
Yes, indifference between people.
Indifference.
We are good. Okay, you hurt me, I say hi, but that's all. No trying to restore our relationship. Say far from hi, okay. You hurt me, it's all right, never mind. But they are not trying to rebuild the relationship. Indifference. Okay, read.
Ingratitude fails or refuses to acknowledge divine charity and to return him love for love.
Yeah, ingratitude to God especially. God has blessed us so much. God has blessed us from so many sickness and troubles we are not aware. We have taken it for granted. Indifferent to God. So what? Is that? It's done. Read further.
Lukewarmness is hesitation or negligence in responding to divine love. It can imply refusal to give oneself over to the prompting of charity.
Lukewarmness. Yes or no? Both. What does God say in the book of Revelation? I will spit you out of my mouth if you are lukewarm, if you are indifferent. You either be for God, you be against God. There is only two ways. Either be for God or you are against God. There is no in-between way. That is lukewarmness. God said, I will spit you out in the book of Revelation. Read. I will spit you out. Read further.
Acedia or spiritual sloth goes so far as to refuse the joy that comes from God and to be repelled by divine goodness.
Spiritual love. What is spiritual love? Doing for the sake of doing. Okay, I'm coming to church. Okay, I'm helping you, I'm doing it. Okay, I'll do this, I'll do it. Spiritual sloth. No love in our hearts. When somebody comes to help, okay, we know we have to help. Okay, take, go. No love. Spiritual sloth. Refusal to do work, God's work. Refusal to do housework. This is all spiritual sloth. All the time I want to be gossiping, reading TV. I have nothing against what you are doing or what we do. I am only pointing out what the scriptures tell us. Read further.
Hatred of God comes from pride.
Yes.
It is contrary to love of God, whose goodness it denies and whom it presumes to curse as the one who forbids sin and inflicts punishment.
Yes. Hatred of God. Hatred of God comes from pride. There are so many ways we have pride in us. The receiver of all sins, pride. Why should I go to this fellow man? Why should I talk to this lady? Why should I do this? I am better off. Self-righteousness. So my dear friends, brothers and sisters, my children, time up. All good things must come to an end. And it is almost, I exceeded 5 minutes. Please forgive me. Please also, let's pray for one another and submit ourselves to the Lord. So just say the prayer after me. Close your eyes. Search me, O Lord. All together. Search me, O Lord.
Search me, O Lord.
And know my heart.
And know my heart.
Touch me, O Lord.
Touch me, O Lord.
And know my thoughts.
And know my thoughts.
Lead me.
Lead me.
In the right way.
In the right way.
Amen.
Amen.